Today I'm going to discuss the topic of good versus evil. The world is upside down with what they think is good and what they think is evil in comparison to what their creator says is good and what he says is evil. People want to say that Christianity is good because they think that they do good works and they don't stone adulterers and homosexuals and such as some in Islam do. Well, is obeying our creator good or is it evil? Is disobeying him good or is it evil? Is it his will that we obey his word or not? He gave us his instructions to shape his character in us so that we could be given eternal life in his family through walking in them. Is anyone who takes you away from his instructions good or are they evil? Here's what my father says in Deuteronomy 13. You shall walk pursuing Yahweh Elohim and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice, and you shall serve him and cleave to him. And that prophet or that dreamer of dreams shall be put to death because he has spoken to turn you away from Yahweh Elohim, which brought you out of the land of Egypt and redeemed you out of the house of bondage, to draw you out of the way which Yahweh Elohim commanded you to walk in. So shall you put or burn the evil away from the midst of you. He tells us plainly that any person who speaks words that take you away from him and his path must be put to death. He says this because he knows that what takes us away from him is evil, because it leads to death. Most people in Christianity would say that Islam is evil, and it is, but in the coming days, your creator is going to empower these people and others to overtake you and to utterly destroy you. You might want to rethink your position on evil and compare yourself to his measuring rod that was given to you, instead of comparing yourself to a people who are not his people. Yes, Islam has much evil in their midst, but they did not have my father's spirit to guide them, available to them like you have had. I'll give you some examples of the evil that's in your midst. Is it evil that you have not taught your children to live your creator's every word? Why haven't you? You were commanded to. We read this in Deuteronomy 6. And these words which I commanded you this day shall be in your heart, and you shall diligently teach them to your children, and you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. Are you doing this? Is not doing this evil, or is it good? He gave us his word to teach us to think like he thinks so that we could be fashioned by it to be in agreement with him. Your choice to not teach his instructions to your children and to teach lies to them that came from Saul of Tarsus, who took you away from Yahweh's path, is blasphemous and abominable to him and evil to your children. It's evil because it teaches them a path that leads not to my father's kingdom, but to the lake of fire. It is a different path that Yeshua taught us to walk on, and he said, follow me. He was the very thoughts and the very character of his father in the flesh. He did not teach the path that Saul of Tarsus taught. He taught a path of walking in the statutes. You base your worship after the traditions of pagan religions like Christmas and Easter or Sunday worship or Saturday worship. Is this evil or is this good? Yeshua said, in doing so, you worship him in vain. What does Yahweh say about this subject in Deuteronomy 12? Take heed to yourself that you be not snared by following them, and desolate them before your face, lest you inquire after their gods, saying, how do these nations serve their gods? Even so will I do likewise. He's sitting there saying that we do not follow after the way the pagan nations worship their gods. Verse 31, you shall not do so to Yahweh Elohim, because every abomination to Yahweh which he hates have they done to their gods. For even their sons and their daughters they have burnt it in the fire to their gods. And that's what you're doing too. If you're not teaching your children to walk in his statutes, you're just condemning them to death. And of course they could still choose after in the later courses of their life, as times went on, to choose to walk in his paths themselves. But you would be an example to them. Verse 32, what things soever I command you, observe to do it, and you shall not add thereto or diminish from it. If you're worshiping him on the fixed day of the week on the Roman calendar Sunday, you're claiming that you worship him on the day of the sun god, and you are rejecting his instructions. Is this evil when he told us how to determine when we are to come before him, or is it good? If you say that you think that it does not matter, is it evil or is it good to not fear going against him? Is telling him how and when you will worship him good or evil? How about you Saturday worshipers? Have you done your homework, or do you just simply believe those who say they are Jews today? The Jewish people fixed their day of worship to Saturday on the pagan Roman calendar in the 4th century. Before that, they correctly used our Creator's calendar to determine when his Sabbaths are. Was this good or was it evil that they changed this timing? If you understand that according to Isaiah and according to Daniel, Satan purposed to make these changes, thus those who follow his instructions are following him instead, maybe you can acknowledge that your decisions have been evil in my Father's sight because you have went astray from his perfect path and chose right from wrong for yourselves and chose to be led by Satan. Surely you would admit that Satan's path is evil, wouldn't you? He has cleverly disguised evil indeed. He has deceived billions into following him, and his followers call good evil, and they call evil good. Yeshua told the Jews of that day that they were of their father, the devil, because his logos had no place in them. I tell you in Christianity the same thing today. You are of your father, the devil, and you are evil because my father's logos has no place in you either. You think that your deeds are good. Well, our Messiah told us plainly that we can be identified by our fruits, and he said that our fruits are not our good deeds in and of themselves. Our good deeds will be automatic if we are walking in agreement with him, because they are commanded, and they would simply be part of the way of life that we live if we're walking with him. No, the fruits that he is referring to are something else. He tells us what the fruits of those who will not be allowed in his Father's kingdom are in Matthew 7. Start off in verse 13. Enter in at the straight gate, because wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go this way. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leads to life, and there are few that find it. Why? Because the wide gate is an easy path. You can decide right from wrong for yourself, and you don't have to fear going against your Maker. You don't have to fear losing out on what he wants to give you. Verse 15, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. You can recognize them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree brings forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree brings forth evil fruit. So he tells us that we can know who is false and who is true by their fruits. He is speaking of good versus evil here, and he is going to go on and tell you what is evil if you will listen. He is also telling us that these false prophets are going to appear to be good because they appear to be sheep. They carefully define what they think good is and hide behind it. They use the obvious good of good deeds to cloak the real good that they walk in the darkness in doing so, just as you do if you hide behind your good deeds and feel good about yourself for all of the good that you think that you do. If you would just believe that we were created to take on our Creator's character and to purge out evil from our midst, then maybe you could wake up to the fact that anything that opposes his plan to make us in his image is evil. Not just the obvious evils like abortions or murder and such. Stop letting your values determine good versus evil and let your Creator's instructions tell you what is good and what is evil. Yeshua goes on in verse 18, a good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Why? Because a good tree only wants the will of his Father and hates that which is evil in his sight. And a bad tree wants to make their Creator in the image that they want him to be so that they can determine right from wrong for themselves. In verse 19, every tree that brings not forth good fruit is cut down and cast into the fire. You had better start fearing not having the good fruit, and the good fruit is much more than good deeds or charitable donations. Of course we must do these things, but not to let these things replace the real reason that we were created. To do so is evil because it works against our Creator's will to build his family by molding us in his image. Verse 20, therefore by their fruits you can recognize them. Not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father which is in heaven. Only those who do the will of his Father will be allowed in his family. Do you think that it might be important to learn what his Father's will is? Is it his will that we be made in his image or not? He goes on to say that the deceived thought that they were good to go because of their good deeds, and he also tells us that they were confessing that he was their Lord and using his name with their mouths. Verse 22, many will say to me that in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, and have we not cast out devils in your name, and done many wonderful works in your name? And then I will profess to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work anomia, you that do or practice transgression of the law, is what he's saying here. He told them what their fruits were that separated them from him and from his father's kingdom. Anomia is the Greek word for lawlessness or transgression of the law. Sin is transgression of his father's law, 1 John 3:4. If you say differently, you call your Savior a liar and you call the Apostle John a liar. If you think that your fruits are your good deeds apart from my father's Torah, you have chosen to remain in captivity and you have rejected the truth that was given to you to set you free. It continues in the next verse. Therefore, whosoever hears my logos and does it or lives it, I will liken him to a wise man which built his house upon a rock. My father is pleading that each of you flee the lies that came from the teachings of Saul of Tarsus and return to his Torah that he gave us to teach us his character or his logos. Saul was evil. Following Saul is evil because doing so takes us away from the truth that would set us free. His logos is truth. Your pastor is evil if he does not lead you to your Savior's logos, and which he said was not his logos, but his father's logos that sent him. Those calling themselves Jewish today are evil for perverting his Torah in all of the ways that they have as well, but especially for continuing to pervert the way that Yahweh's appointed times are to be determined. The Jewish people in the 4th century jumped right into Satan's lap when they did this, but many of those in Judaism today know that this was done, and they continue to choose to follow Satan by refusing to repent. And millions follow their false calendar today, so they are leading millions away astray and away from our Creator's path, and they are worshiping him in vain and teaching others to worship him in vain. Is this good or is this evil? I'm sure that most of you would agree that it is evil to tread the blood of the Most High Son underfoot, or evil to teach others to do so. Well, do you think that treading underfoot, the reason that he shed his blood would be treading his blood underfoot? I think that you would agree that it would be. Scripture teaches us that he shed his blood so that we could be forgiven, so that we could enter into a covenant or a contract with his Father, where his Torah would be written in our hearts and in our inward parts. This contract involves us signing our part of it by turning from our ways and turning to his ways or his path. If you claim that you're under the covenant of his blood without signing your part of it by turning to his father's path, you tread his blood underfoot and you are evil for doing so, no matter how many good deeds that you do. I suggest that you start focusing on what your Creator calls evil and not what you think is evil comparing yourself to others. Even examine your thoughts on what evil is, what you call obvious evil. You say that Islam is evil for stoning the adulterer. Well, we were commanded to do this in order to put out this evil from our midst. Adultery is evil and it destroys relationships and it is hateful. It is not love and it causes so much hurt and destroys so many families, and it's just sick and it's perverted that this has been allowed to continue on. Yet Christianity so often just turns the other cheek and this evil continues in your midst. Yeshua pardoned the woman that was brought to him because she was broken and her accusers had left. He seen that she was broken over her transgression, yet he still admonished her to go and sin no more. To say that he did away with this law is calling him a liar, because he said that he did not come to get rid of one punctuation mark from within the law. He showed her mercy because of her brokenness, plus there were no witnesses left to condemn her. He used the opportunity to teach them that they had better to be looking at their own transgressions and their own hypocrisy before condemning another, just as each of us had better to do, but in no way was he changing his father's law. He brought clarification to it and magnified the law, just as he was prophesied he would. How about homosexuality? You condemn Islam for stoning the homosexual, and you embrace homosexuality in your midst. This is pure evil. This is not about comparing you to Islam, because again, they did not have our Creator's Spirit available to them like you did. If anyone enjoys the act of stoning another for any reason, they have pure evil hearts indeed. But this does not mean that we should not seek to purge out evil either. At least Islam knows that adultery and homosexuality is evil. It was atrocious that many in Islam were passing out candies in the street after the murder recently of a Jewish family. But it is also atrocious that the nations of Israel were supposed to be an example to them and to the rest of the world on how to serve Elohim and how to live as his children. And these nations could have witnessed the benefits of this as well. He wanted us involved in helping him bring them to him as well. We were commanded to be an example to the nations. Instead, Christianity took a false gospel that came from Saul of Tarsus to the world and led billions away from the truth that would have set them free. Those in Islam hate the West because of the West's hypocrisy and their self-righteousness. If you think that the adulterer should not be stoned or the false teacher who takes you away from our Creator's path should not be stoned, you simply are more righteous than he is. Don't worry, he's about ready to take care of this for you, because his wrath is coming, and it is coming against you primarily over all of the nations, because you were given his truth to be an example to the other nations. Today is the 17th day of the second month in his calendar, and it is the same day as the floodwaters began over 4,100 years ago. We are only 11 days away from the end of a 40-day period of judgment that he has extended to the scattered nations of Israel who drifted into Christianity. He has finished building his temple, and he has been holding back his wrath for such a long time but now his judgment is coming. The fourth trumpet will begin to blow at the end of this day today, but the major effects of it will continue to be held back for a short season longer, just as the first three have been. There is a false teacher named Harold Camping that has calculated today as the day of a make-believe rapture, but he is right about one thing. Judgment is coming. I listened to some of his teachings and never found one segment teaching my father's Torah, just as all false teachers only teach parts of it or none of it, so he is easily determined as false. He even upholds Sunday worship, although he is right that the churches in Christianity are deceived. One thing that I marveled at in briefly listening to him is how sincere he is that he has the truth. Satan certainly is good at grounding his servants in their false beliefs. They believe that they are right with all of their being. Most all of you will think that I am the one that is deceived. Well, compare what I say to the words of our Messiah and the rest of the prophets. Am I taking you to his Torah or away from it? Compare Saul's words to them as well. Did Saul lead you to the Torah or away from it? Did Yeshua lead you to the Torah or away from it? How about the Apostle John? How about Matthew? Go right on down the list. Isaiah, Moses, any of them, just right down the list. Saul had a different message. Yeshua said that he is the way and the truth and the light, and that he was his father's logos in the flesh. Christianity is pure evil for perverting his words. Judaism is pure evil for perverting his words, but you both would rather compare yourselves to Islam, who did not have his spirit available to them because you did not live the truth as an example for them so that they would want his spirit. You continue to receive our Creator's blessings that he promised to Abraham, but you have mocked why he created us and why he gave us these blessings by rejecting his truth. In Isaiah 5, verse 20, we read, "Woe to them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to them who are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight." Do you think that choosing right from wrong for yourselves is good, or is it evil? Our Creator thinks it is evil. This is why Adam and Eve were shut out from the garden and cut off from his spirit. Do different rules apply for you and I than for them? Just go back to the fruits that Yeshua said that we can use to determine if someone has good fruit or evil fruit. Look into what he meant by lawlessness. What law do you think that he was talking about? Why does his father say that he is going to rise up these peoples against Israel in the last days? Why is he going to empower these nations to overcome Israel? If you think that he is only talking about the physical nation of Israel, you will soon find out that you are sorely in error. In Matthew 13, he says, "The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that snare others, and them which do anomia," or them that practice transgression of the law, "and shall cast them into a furnace of fire, and there shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth." Do You think that you have not snared your children to believe lies by not teaching them to that your Creator's instructions are in place as Yeshua taught us that they are? Do you think that Saul's teachings snared others and took them away from the narrow path? Or do you think that his teachings led others to the narrow path? Have you done the same by following Saul's teachings yourself instead of following your Messiah? In Matthew 23, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. And I can say the same thing to you today. Woe to you, those in Christianity, hypocrites, because you are like sepulchres painted white, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but within are full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness. Even so, you outwardly appear righteous to men in your own self-righteousness, but within you are full of hypocrisy and anomia, you're full of transgression of the law. Because the law has no place in you, because his word has no place in you. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Woe to you in Christianity, hypocrites, because you build the tombs of the prophets and adorn the sepulchres of the righteous. You talk about Abraham and such and use and lift up their names, but yet you reject everything that his servants have taught you and everything that they lived as an example for you. In verse 30, and say, if we had lived in the days of our fathers, we would not have been partakers with them in the blood of the prophets. That's what you'd say today. We wouldn't kill the Messiah, yet you kill him every day by continuing to reject what he taught. You trampling his blood underfoot. Therefore, you will be witnesses to yourself that you are the children of them which killed the prophets. He said that they would prove their own hearts because they would kill him, just as you will be witnesses to your own hearts by wanting me dead when it is your Creator who has sent me to expose your hypocrisy and to beg you to repent, just as Yeshua cried out when he came for them to repent. If you want to deny what sin is, you will die in your sins. 1 John 3:4 says plainly that sin is anomia. It is transgression of the law. If you want to say, oh, that's just the Ten Commandments and the rest of them have been done away with, show me where that is written apart from Saul's teachings. And of course, you have to twist some of Saul's teachings, but he certainly led people away from the Torah without a doubt. People want to claim that he kept it. Well, what did he teach? Mixed in, just made it kind of a matter of a back burner type of thing. But just to prove your hypocrisy, let's say that you are right and it is just referring to the Ten Commandments. How do you think that you are faring on number 4, the Sabbath day, if you are profaning it by changing the timing of it to a day on Satan's calendar, rejecting your Creator's calendar? Changing Yahweh's appointed times is pure evil. I certainly have no need to go into the rest of the 10 because most of you break every one of them. Most importantly, you have committed adultery with your Creator and his Son by your whoredom to his covenant. In 1 Samuel 16, we read, but Yahweh said to Samuel, look not on his countenance or on the height of his stature, because I abhor such, because Yahweh sees not as a man sees, because a man looks on the outward appearance, but Yahweh looks in the heart. I hear this last line of this verse quoted by my father's enemies often. Oh, they say, God knows my heart. Yes, he does. He knows those who refuse to listen to him and want to tell him how it is. Why do you think that what he sees in your heart is a good thing? Is it because you go to church on Sundays or because you enjoy singing praise songs? Maybe it's because you feel compassion for all of the starvation around the world, or you help the elderly, or any other good deed that you feel good about. Again, these things are not bad. They are required to be a way of life, but they are not teaching you his character, which is why you were created. You're denying his blueprint is what makes your beliefs evil in spite of your good deeds. You were not created to simply do good deeds. They are merely a byproduct of walking with him, not the instructions in and of themselves. Do you want to? They're certainly part of it. We certainly have commanded to do them, but they're certainly a lot more than good deeds. Do you want to know what kind of heart my father is looking for to be in his family? Look at David's heart. Look at Abraham's heart. Look at Yeshua's heart. Look at the hearts of all of the saints that are recorded in the scripture. Oh, how they long to walk in the statutes and ordinances and judgments of Yahweh, their Elohim. Did they make mistakes? Absolutely. But oh, how they sought to walk with him and be in his favor. And oh, how they remorse when they transgressed against him. They feared losing out on his offer to be his children. He is pleading with you this day to flee from all that is evil. And he is telling you that anything that takes you away from him by taking you away from his instructions is evil. Sadly, most of you will reject what he is telling you this day, and you will die in your lawlessness. You will continue to tread your Messiah's blood underfoot. Prepare to be brought down if this is the case, because he is not going to allow your hard hearts into his family, nor is he going to allow that which destroys relationships to continue to destroy them. If you will not hearken to him, that is your choice. Keep following your boy Saul into the lake of fire. It really is sad that you will not believe my father and his son and his servants, the prophets. Instead, you want to believe liars because their path is broad and more suitable to your taste buds. In doing so, you have rejected his offer to be made in his image and become his children. I started this video off with some questions. Is obeying our Creator good or is it evil? Is obeying him good? Is disobeying him good or is it evil? Is it his will that we obey his word or not? And why did he give us his word? Each of you is going to have to decide which side you want to be on, his side, or do you want to continue to be on Satan's side? You cannot have it both ways. If you want to continue to be on the side of rebellion to him, prepare to be purged out.